Nearly 98% of Antarctica is covered with ice, up to 3 miles thick in some locations. After spending a couple weeks at the McMurdo station, I placed my microscopes and a sleeping bag into a helicopter to venture to a unique part of Antarctica known for its lack of ice, the Dry Valleys. The Dry Valleys are host to a few tiny field camps of researchers, often only half a dozen people at each. My first stop was Lake Bonney to spend a week camping at the frozen lake looking for microbes living underneath the ice.
So I've just arrived in the Dry Valleys for the very first time, and it is nothing short of incredible. I actually really don't have words to describe just how alien and awesome it is here. I actually feel like I need to whisper because this place is just so amazing. It's really unlike anything I've done being here in Antarctica at Lake Bonney, the site of Blood Falls. And we're just camping out here amongst the mountains and with all the little microbes around us. And it's, yeah, I don't have words. It's pretty special. The Dry Valleys here in Antarctica are cool not only for looking like an alien landscape, they are the largest patch of dry land, essentially land that is not touched by ice or snow in all of Antarctica. Antarctica is nearly the size of North America. You're often wondering, what is exactly beneath my feet? I'm on the continent, but I'm on tons of ice and snow. What's beneath my feet? What does the continent itself look like? Well, it looks something like this. Garden. It was pretty strenuous, at least for me, hike to get up here, but it's absolutely beautiful. You can see there's all these windswept rocks behind me. We're actually near an area called the Upland Ponds from Lake Bonney, where a lot of microbial mats are, and we're just checking things out around here, and then we're gonna go for dinner.
I'm here at the Lake Bonney camp inside the James Way. This is the name of the structure that I'm actually in. And this is our common area. So this is where we eat. You can see a lot of the pantry items behind me. If I go over here, you can sort of, it's bright, but you can see there's a cooking area, regular stove. And then over here is a lot of desks. And you can see right there, that's actually my microscopy area where I'm looking at a lot of the microbes and doing a lot of the work. This space is really fantastic, having a common area. There's Christmas lights, it's quite cozy, and it's just a nice area to catch up with everyone else at the camp. We've got about a dozen people or so in the camp right now, so for Lake Bonney, that's actually quite crowded, but it's fun getting to hear about everyone's different science projects and catch up with them at the end of each day. A lot of people say the Dry Valleys is the closest thing to being on Mars. Right now, I am actually going around hiking, looking at the shoreline and some of the different sediments around here, and sampling different types of microbes to see what we can see.
Right now, Ariel, you are standing on about 3.8 meters of ice, so almost 12 feet of ice. And you're looking at the water column of Lake Bonney. It starts here. This is the freeboard, so the distance from the ice cover that the lake water came up. And the water goes down here, almost 42 meters in depth.
How many times have you been to Blood Falls?
Oh, how many times?
Or how many years have you been coming?
How many years have I been coming down? Well, 13 seasons to Antarctica. So 12 to McMurdo and 11 to the Dry Valleys. So yeah, it's been some time.
I'm excited about this hole.
So I am actually at Blood Falls. You can see it right behind me. It is this amazing, amazing thing. It's really a monument to science. So you used to think it was algae. It's actually iron oxide. It's just absolutely beautiful to actually see it in person and not in photos, and to actually get to experience it and hopefully take some samples from here and look at them under the microscope. We also had a bit of late night fun at the camp with the microscopes, just looking at whatever was lying around at 2 or 3 in the morning. Some of the scientists were pretty excited to have a microscope to play around with for the first time.
I've been sleeping over here at Lake Bonney for a few nights, and it definitely gets cold in the evenings. So there are a few different techniques you can use inside your tent, which I am right now, to get a little bit warmer. One is throwing your big red coat over your sleeping bag. Another is having hand warmers handy. Another technique is having a hot water bottle with boiling water in it to keep either your feet or your belly warm. This definitely is one of my most important things that I go to bed with. Also, you know, at Lake Bonney, there's actually no showers, so everyone here just kind of deals with it. Essentially, showers take the form of this. This is a good way of keeping clean while you're here at Lake Bonney. Some people are here for several weeks, some people are here for only a few days, so you definitely have to get creative with both how to keep warm and how to keep clean.
Today is my last day here at Lake Bonney, and I've had a really heartwarming experience getting to know all of the scientists, getting to get a feel for the camp, and just getting settled into a way of life here, even for only a few short days. I am now headed to Lake Houra, which is a larger camp and has more infrastructure, so I'm interested to compare the two. But here at Lake Bonney, I've just had a fantastic experience, and it really is hard to really grasp that I'm here in Antarctica and here literally camping amongst the mountains, and what an incredible experience that is. I don't think I fully grasp how it will affect me. Perhaps that's something that I'll find out more when I go home. On the next episode, I hike up a glacier to drill into it in search of tardigrades living embedded in the ice. To catch all the episodes of my Antarctic expedition, be sure to subscribe to my YouTube channel. My Antarctic work is ongoing, and you can support it and these videos by joining my Patreon. Thanks to all my patrons for making this possible, and a special shout out to the patrons listed in the YouTube description below. You're spectacular. Also, thanks to the National Science Foundation Antarctic Artists and Writers Program, the San Francisco Microscopical Society, National Geographic, and the many Antarctic researchers, friends, and colleagues who helped support my work along the way.